Chances are you know someone who's had breast cancer. It's been estimated that as many as 13% of people assigned female at birth will get it at some point in their lives. Given that we're more than 50% of people on the planet, that's a lot of breast cancer. Plus, you can get breast cancer even if you're not female. The good news is we've learned a lot about the disease in recent years. So today, we're gonna take a look at what breast cancer is, how it's diagnosed, and what we can do about it. So to start with, breast cancer isn't just one thing. Of course, a cancer is considered a breast cancer if it originates in the breast, aka mammary tissue. They're most common in the milk ducts, which are called ductal carcinomas, or the milk-producing lobules, which are called lobular carcinomas. There are also cancers that can occur in the breast that can happen elsewhere too. For instance, there's a cancer called angiosarcoma that affects your blood or lymph vessels. But when an angiosarcoma happens in breast tissue, you guessed it. It's thought of still as a breast cancer. And even rarer than that, people can even get breast cancer without it being in the breast at all. See, some people are born with mammary tissue outside of the breast, which is known as supernumerary or ectopic breast tissue. And that tissue can develop breast cancer, just like the correctly located kind. A 2019 case study reported on a 36-year-old female patient who had breast cancer in some ectopic breast tissue in her left armpit, without any sign of tumors in her breasts. The armpit is the most common place for ectopic breast cancer, but it can also grow in other places, like your thighs or your groin. And these body parts aren't included in routine breast cancer examinations for somewhat obvious reasons. So these cancers can end up not getting diagnosed as early as other ones would. Which brings us to the diagnosis process. How does someone find out they have breast cancer? The earliest symptoms of breast cancer are usually small, if you can see them at all. They can look a lot of ways, but here are the major red flags. People should be on alert for lumps in the breast or armpits, or a change to the size and feel of your breasts, or red, puckered, or rough skin on the breasts, or a change in the position of the nipples, or your nipples leaking fluid when they shouldn't be, so not during pregnancy or breastfeeding. And as alarming as all that sounds when I say them all out loud, in reality, these symptoms can be pretty subtle. And that's why the National Breast Cancer Foundation recommends self-examination on top of these routine mammograms to spot those early signs as soon as possible. If your doctor is worried about any of these things, they may get an ultrasound of your breast, or possibly even a mammogram, which is a type of x-ray specifically designed to take images of breast tissue. And they do this by squishing the breast tissue between two plates to spread it out as much as possible, which is about as fun as it sounds. If your doctor sees something concerning on that mammogram, then you'll need a biopsy. And if that biopsy detects cancer, then your doctor will work to see how far it's spread, aka what stage the cancer is. To learn more about how cancer staging works, you can check out the video we made all about it. And look, mammograms may not be fun, but they are really important, especially as you get older. A mammogram can detect some cancers before you can even feel them, so getting one when your doctor recommends it is always a good call. Most patients are told to start getting regular mammograms quite later in life, but that can change depending on what risk factors they happen to have. And there are a lot of potential risk factors for breast cancer, so here we're just going to touch on a few. The one thing I want to emphasize is that these are risk factors, not causes. There's nothing that causes anyone to get any kind of cancer, but there are certain things that can increase your risk. Being assigned female at birth is the biggest one for breast cancer, because most breast cancers occur in people who are anatomically female. But people of any sex can get breast cancer, so no matter what, it's important to be aware of the signs and the symptoms, and if you're concerned, to get checked. You're also more likely to get breast cancer as you grow older, especially once you're over 50. Other breast cancer red flags are if you have a family history of it, if you started menstruating before the age of 12, or if you're overweight after menopause. There are lots of other risk factors too, but again, they're risk factors, not direct causes. So it's still important to keep up with self-exams, whether you've got all of these or even none of them. So now that we know a bit more about what breast cancers are, let's take a look at how they grow. Many breast cancers are regulated by estrogen and progesterone, which are hormones that perform a whole bunch of functions in our bodies. They're good things, normally. But breast cancer cells can have estrogen and progesterone receptors on their surfaces, and when those hormones bind to them, it triggers those cancer cells to grow out of control. So the same hormones that you need for all sorts of essential stuff just so happen to be Miracle-Gro for breast cancer cells. Another key player in breast cancer growth is increased levels of a protein called human epidermal growth factor receptor 2, or HER2. Breast cancers are called hormone or HER2 positive when they're sensitive to any of the three things we just mentioned. And fortunately for us, those same same receptors are basically a built-in cheat code for treatment for those types of cancers. Doctors can use targeted treatments to lower the levels of hormones in the body, blocking the hormone's receptors, and they can also use antibodies to neutralize the HER2 protein. No growth factor means no growth of the tumor. But around 15 to 20% of breast cancers don't have receptors for estrogen, progesterone, or HER2, and these are called triple-negative breast cancers. Triple-negative breast cancers are extra aggressive, and they're the ones that are more likely to spread into other organs. And because the targeted treatments used for hormone and HER2 positive cancers don't work here, doctors have to fall back on more conventional cancer therapies like surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation to get the job done. More on that in a minute. Researchers are working hard to understand the mechanisms involved in triple negative breast cancers, but there's a lot of factors that gum up the process there. One of these complex factors is, of course, genetics. You may have heard of two genes involved in breast cancer, BRCA1 and BRCA2. These are commonly referred to as tumor suppressor genes because they help repair damaged DNA. At least they do when they're working correctly. But when BRCA1 and 2 are mutated, they drastically increase the risk of some cancers. Like I mentioned at the start, research shows that as many as 13% of all females may develop breast cancer in their lifetime. But for people who've inherited a BRCA1 mutation, that rate goes up to between 55 to 72%, and it's between 45 and 69% for BRCA2. BRCA mutations also increase the risk of developing ovarian cancer, pancreatic cancer, prostate cancer, all for the people who have those. And so these BRCA mutations are like quadruple whammies. But the good news is that there's a particular class of drugs that have been found to effectively stop the growth of cancer cells with BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations specifically. Plus, BRCA mutations aren't very common in the general population. Only around 1 in 450 people have them. There are also genetic tests to detect if you have a BRCA mutation. So patients with a family history of those cancers we mentioned, they can have screenings to determine their individual risks. But BRCA genes aren't the only cancer-associated mutations out there. There are a bunch of other genes associated with increased risk of breast cancer, although we don't have time to get through all of them in this video. But there's another way someone's genes can affect their risk of cancer, and it's much harder to detect. Epigenetic changes are molecular changes that can alter gene activity, like increasing or decreasing its expression. And they do this without changing the DNA sequence itself. It can be like using a highlighter to emphasize some writing, or like a black marker to smudge it out. One way to do this is to add an organic compound called a methyl group to specific spots on your DNA, which tell your cells how to read that section. New research has found that 20% of triple-negative breast cancer patients were negative for BRCA1 gene mutations, but they did have that gene methylated, meaning that even someone who tests negative for BRCA1 mutations can still end up with a BRCA-related cancer, which is pretty frustrating. But as we learn more about how breast cancers work, researchers are getting better at making super targeted treatments. For example, one study looking at over 500,000 women diagnosed with invasive breast cancer in England found that the risk of dying from breast cancer has decreased from 15% in the 1990s to around 5% from 2010 to 2015. And a lot of that is thanks to more effective treatments. With cancers whose growth is driven by hormones, one way to treat them is to use hormone therapy. For instance, you can try to block the body's ability to produce those hormones in the first place. One way to turn down the hormone production is by targeting the ovaries, which are the main sources of estrogen and progesterone. And the easiest way to stop ovaries from making hormones is to remove them. There's also targeted radiation, but with both of these treatments, the goal is to make sure the ovaries just stop working altogether. So there's a pretty clear downside, especially if you're a person who wanted to use your ovaries later on. Other hormone-based treatments try to stop the effects of the hormones on just the cancer cells, which is a lot less drastic. But hormone manipulation won't be the treatment for all the kinds of breast cancer out there. With those triple-negative breast cancers, where hormones aren't driving the cancer growth, the main treatment is usually either surgery to remove the tumor or a mastectomy to remove the whole breast. And then, of course, we have chemo. Chemotherapy uses drugs to target fast-growing cells, and it does this by disrupting the processes that those cells use to divide. Chemo can come with some pretty nasty side effects, like hair loss and mouth sores and infections. That's because those chemotherapy drugs disrupt all the fast-growing cells they find, whether they're cancer or just your body's normal fast-growing cells, like hair and skin, which is why all those other more targeted treatments are really appealing too. Still, if it's a choice between breast cancer and mouth sores, well, I know which one I'm choosing. There are a lot of other treatments out there, which we have thanks to decades of research into this family of diseases. So even though it can seem grim, there has never been a better time to be a person in treatment for any kind of cancer. And as we learn more, we can do more to detect and treat breast cancers more effectively, which is good for all of us. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow, and an extra big thank you to our patrons over on Patreon. Your support keeps these lights on, and we couldn't make videos like this without you. We think you're awesome.